Adams, who is a lawyer, working mainly in London but also in Moscow. And he's going to be talking to you today about counterfeiting in all its various guises. There will be room for talk, room for questions at the end, so I hope that you'll be thinking of questions as the talk progresses. And I hope that you will take on board what he's been talking about. So, with no further ado,
counterfeit goods are not made with the same high quality materials or standards as regular products. The deceit is health and safety concerns for the consumer by you paying.
So, what is a trademark? device, or any combination of those that identifies and distinguishes the source of goods of one party from everybody else. So trademarks are to distinguish, somebody's goods and set them apart from everybody else. It's how you get to choose the products that you want. So a simple example, this is an American slideshow. Big Mac is a trademark. You all know what a Big Mac is. You all know if you want to go into McDonald's and ask for a Big Mac, you know exactly what you're going to get. You also know that if you go into Burger King, there is no point asking for a Big Mac because Burger King doesn't do a Big Mac, into McDonald's. So a trademark is perfectly enabling you to make the right decision and look for what you want and to distinguish Burger King's goods from McDonald's. Not just words, new designs. Anybody want to shout out what brand that is? You don't need to see the word Shell to know that that's Shell. As you're driving along and from some distance you see this company label sign coming out inside the road, you know that's going to be a Shell printer. There again, that one. You don't need the word Pepsi on the side of that. Drinks bottle to know that that is an oil test. You recognize that from the logo on the side. Trademarks don't just distinguish goods, they also distinguish services. So, for example, American Express, Visa, MasterCard, those are all the service marks which distinguish services. Maybe that was really interesting, so non-traditional trademarks. Does that colour mean anything to any of you? I'm a little bit too young. Anyone want to shout out what that colour signifies? Is that shout out to brands going on here? Wow, top marks. Just that colour says continue. In the same way that airline, anything to do with an airline coloured orange would signify easy. So even a single colour can be really, really powerful. You've got to know something to get that sort of reputation. Purple for chocolate. Going a little bit to those and protect them, but when you've got that level of reputation, even a single colour can be useful to play. The very distinctive sound of a Harley Davidson motorcycle been registered as a trademark. Somebody has even registered, it's very little to do, smells. A smell can be distinctive. I haven't done it as far as I'm aware, there's a possibility that Abercrombie & Fitch can register a smell where if you've been into an Abercrombie & Fitch store, you're surrounded by a secondary opinion. Somebody needs to register a smell of roses applied to a car tire, because that's so unusual that if anybody else were to do it, you'd think that car tire must come from the first people to do it. And then things like this impact of McDonald's. Even without the word McDonald's on there and without the M, if all you could see was those yellow canopies arranged around the restaurant that looked like that, most of you think that's a McDonald's. You don't need to see the McDonald's, you don't need to see the M. Just seeing those bits of yellow good. In the same way, looking back to Shell and thinking of BP, the service stations, they were able to register their colour scheme as applied to the design of the service station in order to stop somebody else producing setting up a green service station. If there was a green service station, you're driving down the road, green with a bit of yellow, from a distance, you're going to think that's BP. So we want to be able to stop other people from doing the same thing or something similar and fooling you into going into their service station by themselves. Why are trademarks important to you? They, as we've already said, they help you to distinguish one product from another. They are the easiest possible signifier to you of what it is you're going into a store or going online to buy. When you go out shopping, what's sneaking into clothes, makeup, hair products, you all know, I'm sure, what brand you want, what brand you're interested in before you go to the store. Girls, you don't just go out and buy a makeup, do you? You're going out, you're looking for a particular brand of makeup. Whatever it is, you found it, you know you like it. For whatever reason, that's the one you want, and that's what you're looking for, and you find it because of the trademark that's on the product. I'm sure you don't just wash your hair with any other shampoo. You've all found that there's one that you like, girls in particular, there'll be one that you like, and that's the one that you want to be with. You can identify it by its trademark. So trademarks are phenomenally important to you. It's how you make the decisions when you go shopping. I thought about gin. Gin is another perfect example. You don't just buy gin, do you? You go into a store, you want to buy a particular brand of gin. For whatever reason, advertising, or because you happen to know you like the product, whatever reason, you're looking for that particular brand. That's the power of the trademark. And trademarks are important, of course, for companies that own them as well. For all the same reasons that those products are, the products are identified by those trademarks, so that's really good for you. Of course, that's good for the companies as well. Thinking about, again, about genes. If you did a company develops some new cut of the denim, some new materials to put into the denim to make the denim better, the plastic, the micro going into the denim space, so the jeans stretch a little bit. There's no point developing that fantastic new product if you can't distinguish that from everybody else's products. So the companies that have the best products and the best trademarks tend to do the best. They can't do it without trademarks. The product on its own is not good enough. You've got to have a means of identifying that product and setting it apart from everybody else's, and that's what the trademarks do. So typically, the companies with the best trademarks are the best companies. That's going to be important to you as you leave this place and go on to New York and go on to and you're thinking trademarks. Maybe without realizing it, you don't want to just work for any other company. The company's with a reputation, and that reputation will be attached to the trademark of the company and the trademark of the products that that company sells. So it's a very, very important thing to do. Now, those characters from Amgen, much more fun. There's a supposedly legal definition character, I'm going to read it out. I'm not entirely sure what this tells us. Counterfeiting is the illegal production and sale of goods, including packaging, bearing without authorization a trademark which is identical to somebody else's registered trademark or which cannot be distinguished from it. It's only illegal. Counterfeiting is theft. It's effectively stealing somebody else's trademark. It's using somebody else's trademark when you don't have the right to do it. It's taking a t-shirt, which if you went and sold it and can't lose sale, the plain white t-shirt, you'd be selling it for 50p, but if you put Adidas on it, or Nike, or Superdry, or whatever other brand you get from it, suddenly that t-shirt you can now sell for $5. But if you've stolen somebody else's trademark, you need to do it. We are living in such an enormous group. If anybody can see that, you've got better eyes than I am. I'm going to talk you through some of this. This is some data about scale of IP buying just in the UK. In the UK, we tend to not have that much manufacture of counterfeit goods. Manufacturing, as I'm sure many of you will know, tends to happen in other countries where labor is cheaper, and that applies to counterfeit goods as it goes to everything else. I've been trying in this country largely based by trading standards and demands from the local council. And so the policing of it in this country is not brilliant because, as I'm sure you all know, there have been cutbacks in public expenditure over the last decade or so. Trading standards and demands are not as well funded as they would like to be, so these things are not being tackled as much as they could. But nevertheless, we've got the opposite today. The top five products investigated, cannabis products investigated by traders and owners last year. Top of the pile, tobacco. There are counterfeit bags everywhere. If any of you smoke, I sincerely don't, I'm not judging you. Don't buy your cigarettes from anywhere other than a competitor to sell, because there is a reasonable chance that you can counterfeit. Not that many things worse than ingesting whatever it could be counterfeit cigarette. You've got no idea what goes into those products. Next, clothing, that's a really easy one because it is so easy to make t-shirts, jeans, shirts, coats, whatever. Clothing is really easy. Countless factories in the Far East are showing out clothing very quality. Dead easy to get a piece of clothing and then put a trade on it. Embroider it on, you can see labels here, it's very extreme, very basic. It's very easy to turn a cheap piece of clothing into something with a brand name on, which is suddenly, because it has that trademark, suddenly it's much more saleable and you know much more money. Alcohol, another one, there's a lot of counterfeit alcohol in the UK. Okay, everybody out there buying alcohol? So no more than that. Again, don't buy anywhere other than a reputable outlet. You could be buying counterfeits and that will do you harm. There's some nasty killings there is going to be out. Footwear and DVDs, there are two on there. Okay, easy things, very easy things to cover. Top five links to other criminality. So, to pause and think for a second, the people behind counterfeit goods are making a lot of money out of those counterfeiters, and they are almost connected to other forms of criminality. Benefit fraud is a big one, money laundering, organised crime groups, drug dealing, and violence, which goes along with all of that. So a very simple example, back in the day when the IRA was a problem in Northern Ireland, they had to get their money from somewhere. They had to get money in order to buy arms with which they were in a high struggle in Northern Ireland. And they got a lot of that money from extortion, but also from counterfeit goods. And in any London pub, any London pub on a Friday night, particularly the Irish pubs, there's a very good chance that somebody would come in there with a suitcase full of counterfeit CDs and DVDs. Selling those to the unaware purchasers, and all of that money is going to fund the IRA and their new activities. And then the top 10 locations investigated in counterfeit goods. This is important stuff for you guys to be aware of. Shops is at the top of that list. But right up there, social media, websites, auction sites. They are an absolute haven for counterfeit goods. I'm absolutely certain that virtually anyone who's been here will be shopping for stuff online very regularly. Beware where you're buying and what you're buying on your app. It's very easy, and of course, it's just so easy to hide in the internet. Traders that you're buying your goods from, you don't see them, you don't know who they are. A lot of the time you'll have no comeback at all. There's a lot of websites out there which look like they are UK-based websites, not very well UK websites. Look at the language on the site. Look for spelling mistakes, grammar mistakes. They are almost certain Chinese websites where you will buy goods from that site and we ship directly to you from China. There's a very good chance it won't be exactly what you ordered, it'll be counterfeit, and you've got no comeback whatsoever. And does that happen to anyone? Anyone who bought stuff on the internet and it's just not been right, and you haven't been doing anything about it because you can't find who you sold to? Most of mine will care about the luxury shop, and when you're always in the UK site, okay. Size, the wrong model. They were clearly counterfeit, and here they're trying to communicate with the site that was absolutely impossible. He was getting emails back from somebody who was clearly Chinese, who just said, no, I'm not going to give you a refund, but very, very careful here. It's a little wash.
So that's coming back to you, Max. You're a long way away, you know what that is.
Do you read on something say?
That's a counterfeit. Very, very tempting to go out and buy a counterfeit really rich and bad. Genuinely bad would probably cost £500. There are counterfeits you can wander into shopping sales, panic market, on the internet, you can get a counterfeit which looks like a real thing. £20,000. That's going to be really tempting. I would go over the video. How does that affect you directly? Maybe not very much. Chances are the bad will be a performing quality. There could be all sorts of chemicals used in the process, which is seeping out and may affect you. It's perfectly likely that will look shabby very quickly. A handle might fall off. But for £20, you might be saying to yourself, do you know what? I'll take the risk of £20. Last month or so, big deal. I can't afford to spend £500 on a bag anyway. So I'll take that chance. I'm slightly ready to that argument. I hope everyone knows that argument a little bit. Because the effects of counterfeiting go way beyond the potential effects on you, the purchaser. Now, I believe we're talking about just pause for a second and think. Where has that been made? How has that been made? And who's making the money out of it? And what are they doing with that money? So, it has almost certainly been made in a shoddy factory with very cheap, poorly treated labor in awful conditions. While somebody who is paying them as little as he possibly can so that he makes as much profit as he possibly can. And when he's having made that profit, he's paying no tax on it. Because he's a crook, crooks don't pay tax. He's not declaring his income to anyone. That lack of tax obviously immediately affects all of us, because if there's not as much tax coming in, we're not building as many schools and hospitals, we're not paying our teachers and our doctors, we're not having our public services as deep as they could be because of all that tax money that we're losing. Because even worse than that, you may think that Louis Vuitton haven't lost a sale when you buy a £20 bag because you wouldn't have bought a £500 bag. But hang on, the reason you aspire to a Louis Vuitton bag is because of the kudos of Louis Vuitton. I'm talking very much to the girls. I think of watches as well. You may aspire to a tag watch or a nice meager watch like James Bond's watch. You can go out and get a counterfeit for $20 on the streets of New York or Hong Kong, maybe over here in the UK as well, rather than spending £2,000, £3,000, £4,000 on a watch. You might think that there's no sale being lost by a new Vuitton or a new tag. But because you aspire to that brand, this is why people go out and buy them. These are aspirational brands. People want to be seen wearing these smart watches or carrying around these smart bags. If everybody's got one, because everyone's gone out, or those people have gone out for £120, then suddenly, well, why would you want to pay £500 for it? I mean, you don't look like the smart person with the smart bag or the smart watch. Your aspiration for that brand is gone because it no longer has any kudos. There's a fantastic story about Burberry. I'm sure you all know Burberry. I'm sure many of you have got Burberry brand devices. Burberry is very much a luxury item as well. Burberry baseball caps, a fantastic Burberry check. Baseball caps cost what, 10? Depending on what sort of brand you put on them. They're not expensive pieces of kit. A Burberry baseball cap, £100. Very good.
day of football hooligans invading the pitch and fighting each other. And they nearly all had counterfeit bourbon caps on. And it had become some sort of counterfeit hooligans badge of honour to have a bourbon cap. And the bourbon's reputation went out the window. And nobody wanted to buy a genuine bourbon cap, nobody wanted to buy a genuine bourbon anything. Because their reputation had been shot to pieces by all these football hooligans running around with counterfeit bourbon caps on. And they had to stop making baseball caps and very publicly say, we don't make baseball caps anymore. So the population got a hang of the fact that all of these caps are counterfeit and not to be genuine bourbon caps. So, how does that affection in the community? If Louis Vuitton or Burberry or Tango or Media, if their sales plummet because everyone's running around with counterfeits of their products and nobody wants to buy the genuine products anymore. Now we've got these disreputable factory owners, counterfeiters, making lots of money by exploiting their labour and not paying tax. They're doing well. And a lot of the good companies, the companies who employ people in fantastic conditions, companies who pay their workers well, who pay their taxes, and then their workers pay their taxes, and therefore benefit the community from the tax payer, they're doing that. So counterfeiting has a very direct effect on how well the country is doing. Countries that suffer a lot from counterfeiting have got real problems. Warmed up a little bit. Have any of you, I'm going to ask you now, have any of you seen counterfeit goods? Purchased counterfeit goods? Anyone prepared to admit to having bought counterfeit goods? Yes! I'll admit, before I got involved in all of this, I love watches. Absolutely love watches. And I bought counterfeit watches, extreme vendors in Nigeria, but very easy to do. And the thing I was doing, I don't even know if I had a talk with somebody on these lines. Those of you who have purchased counterfeit goods but weren't necessarily bold enough to say so just now, where did you buy them? Online? Car news site? Some markets? Street markets? Those sorts of places. They tend to be the places where counterfeit goods are most readily available. So online, you absolutely do it. Not sure that helps very much with this. That is a genuine and a fake Nike partnership. You can't tell them apart to look at them. But fake, because it has a happy about your feet. You're fit for life. You need to take care of your feet. You want to be in shoes so they're going to have the right level of support and cushion and blah, 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 blah. The counterfeits here are going to cement the insoles. I think a few things more uncomfortable than feet than that. And utter waste of money. These are phone chargers. Beware of phone chargers. lots of counterfeits around. Please, if your phone charger needs your phone or buy it from a reputable outlet. The counterfeit ones will not be, a very good chance of not being able to get the voltage, and next thing you know, your phone's going to come. This is AES and Nike trading with campus in the store. I think this was a part of this is a very friendly street vendor in Bangkok. Anybody in Bangkok? Yes, loads of street vendors in Bangkok. Loads of people selling counterfeit. It was not a genuine product in sight in street vendors. This is Wiltshire. I'll put this up here, I can tell you a quick story about trying to show you how smart these people are and how big the problem is. Years ago, David Beckham, I hope, was playing Manchester United. He got sold by Manchester United to Real Madrid. David Beckham's shirt number at Manchester United was 7. He couldn't have the number 7 on his shirt at Real Madrid. Everybody knew that because there was an icon playing for Real Madrid called Battle. He was number 7 out of the year, so there was no way Beckham was going to be number 7. Massive
speculation, what number shirt they can get. And it was announced, I think, on Monday morning, in fans over Real Madrid, we did a day at number 23. And that announcement was made at a very time in the morning. We had an office in Bangkok. I rang our office in Bangkok, and I said, right, that's there's a competition for you. I want you to go in the streets. First one who can buy a counterfeit Real Madrid shirt with 23 Beckham on the back gets a prize. And the guy who won that prize was back to me with a photo in an hour. That was how quickly the trade in Bangkok got there. They were all waiting for that news. Printing their shirts and they were on the streets in an hour. Fantastic business in Capital Clothing. That you can't see is air filters, most of them are air filters for four vehicles. There's a big trade in counterfeit car parts. Not much of a problem in this country. It used to be, a massive problem with car manufacturers got around to get. On very few counterfeit car parts in this country. There's an awful lot elsewhere in the world. These countries. So, the problem with obviously, they can be safe and critical. In this case, I'm going to die, but a counterfeit air filter will not filter out as much of the rubbish that gets drawn into your engine with the air as a good filter. And because the rubbish is getting into your engine will not work as well. It will eventually seize and break down much sooner than it would if otherwise. There are countless other examples of Dutch car parts. The best one I ever recently, which is better than people, of course, some of you can do. This is just the little plastic badge that goes in the centre of the exterior. And the company I was working for has some counterfeits of these. These are having to save about $5 each. And the landowner, I think, so it's genuine, so not much more than that. And we didn't have very many of them, and I just thought, that's the big thing. And you don't really want to throw away money at this, trying to solve this, do you? And he was slightly aghast and said, oh my god, yes, you do. Because the baggage sitting in the middle of the steering wheel of your car, if you have an accident, the airbag goes off. That badge is going to fly at you at a speed of, I forget how much, I think it's several hundred miles per hour. If that badge is brilliantly made, as it is by the genuine vehicle manufacturer, that badge will do you no harm whatsoever. But the counterfeit badge, which will be made of much cheaper plastics, is likely to splinter when the bag goes off and kill you. You won't get killed by the car crash, you'll get killed by the sharp badge flying into your chest at 700 miles per hour. And that's something as simple as that. Really, really urgent. These are Coca-Cola labels. We see them trailer a few years ago. How easy is it to make a dark, sweet, cola tasting fizzy liquid? Stick it in a bottle, very easy to make a bottle. Put a red cap on the top, a screen, put a Coca-Cola on it, and print out some labels. Not difficult at all. How are trademarks protected from counterfeiting? Well, people like me, organisations like Trade Standards, laws out there, every country. Orders which enable people to register trademarks, and once they register them, they are then able to protect. But actually, every country will have laws which say that counterfeiting is not just a civil law which you can attack in civil court, but it's a crime. And in the UK, that crime is treated as seriously as theft. Maximum penalty in this country 10 years in prison. Very rarely can we do it, but wait 10 years. Quite regularly get imprisoned for doing manufacturing and for what you need in the counterfeit. Very very serious stuff. So we have the police, who are able to take action. Very rarely do. I think they've got other things to worry about. It is not going to tolerate this unless we can show a connection to something else that's connected to drug dealing, organised crime, and they get to get the interest. Typically, however, it's trade stands for that, so we go to complain, or we take action ourselves. And that, I'm attempting to talk just about it. I have to remember to say this. Remember, trademarks are power. Trademarks transcend language and rules. Counterfeiting is a big problem that affects you. And whether you believe it or not, they have a really important role in the problem and the solution. You, live here, you go through the rest of your life. I do not want to support this illegal trade. I only want to buy genuine goods. Then, if we're going a long way to solving the problem, we will only solve it when people have the awareness and want to buy only genuine goods, the awareness of how to make sure they do. And I hope if there are any doubters amongst you at the start, whether you've got 10 minutes to raise it or you've got the wrong answer. Thank you.
Trademarks, I think, is the Carlsberg logo that they have, and their sort of watchword, probably the best, whatever they're talking about at the time. Exeter University, which some of these people will be applying to and going to, have created their own marketing logo. Exeter, probably the best university in the world, using the same symbol. How do they get away with that?
Well, they get away with it if Carlsberg don't do anything about it.
Okay.
In the same way that supermarkets get away with own brand products which look like the brand leader, because the manufacturer of the brand leader doesn't really want to take action against one of its biggest customers. But obviously that's not the case with Carlsberg. It's difficult slogans. The whole thing about trademark infringement is that you need people to be confused. So something has to be confusingly similar, people have to be misled. Now in counterfeit goods, that's very obvious, because it's a direct pocket, so of course you have to be misled. Less easy with a slogan like that, less easy also when you move away from the core activity that the base slogan protects. So the slogan, probably the best part of the world, that's all about beers. Now we're about an education section. So are people going to be confused into thinking that Exeter University is somehow connected with Carlsberg? Possible. I could mount an argument about that maybe Carlsberg is sponsoring the university somehow. And a lot of people would think that, and Carlsberg might not like that, and therefore Carlsberg might want to stop. But we're moving into, I think it's one of the joys for me, trademarks is very often made black and white. There's a lot of grey in the middle, and of course, the media is a grey. But there's countless other examples. So if I say, have a break, have a... Yeah. Now, what about somebody else produced a chocolate bar and had the expression and sold that in the advertising? or break. And I think Kit Kat and Brian would be very, very cross about that and be able to stop them. But if you move out of confectionery to something completely unrelated, say a car, and use the slogan have a break in connection with a car, would anybody think that Kit Kat was somehow connected with that? Probably not. It's really difficult to see, it's really interesting.
Have the plain packaging rules had an effect on counterfeiting cigarettes?
Not really. There's not that much plain packaging. Plain packaging is in a handful of countries. Probably the greater impact has been from the need to, in this country to implement virtual cigarettes to be very expensive on the counter. Shut away in a cabinet somewhere so that you can't see the products in front of you. So that's made people much more name conscious rather than what was the it's not really had that much of an impact on the cabinet. It's still a big industry of cannabis cigarettes. There's so much money to the more tax that gets applied to a pack of cigarettes and get a higher price goes, and that's just creating a bigger margin for the county. Anyone else?
There's a question around this one.
Yeah? How far does it go with the trademark
sports sunglasses are just good. I have a pair. I was in Canada on streets in Toronto, there's a street seller selling Oakley sunglasses. Now, normally Oakley sunglasses at that time retail in this country for somewhere between £120 and £150, which I didn't have as a student. But I wanted a pair of sunglasses, so I bought my pair of Oakley sunglasses for $5, which is about, at the time, was about £2.50. Very smart look, apart, brought them back, broke them the first time I put them on. So that was the end of them. So lesson learned, perhaps, there. Branding is really important, not just what we've heard about the trademarks. You may have seen the school has been looking at its branding as well. You can see the two slightly different brands on these two images here. It's all about creating brand recognition, making sure that people recognise what the school is outside. So we've done quite a bit of work on that. It's interesting to see that reflecting the work that some of these companies do, the power. I'm afraid I didn't know the Tiffany colour. My wife would probably be quite cross with that. But how recognisable some of these companies manage to make their brand is really powerful. But I think the message today is about social and ethical responsibility and thinking about the impact. And that last image that we were left with really does give that to us very strongly indeed. So I hope you found it interesting, very fascinating topic to me. And thank you, Stuart, for coming in and giving me your time. Thank you.